to get a few things clear from the very beginning. This is not what I had in mind. The bankruptcy bar in this area is aging, and it was my thought that it would be a good idea to get maybe two or three or four young attorneys who could get started on the right path towards bankruptcy law. Obviously, what I've got here is something totally different. So at one point, I thought about canceling the series just because I'm afraid of doing more harm than good. I'm not going to do that, but I'm going to change the ground rules. Number one, I'm going to destroy all the checks. Nobody's going to pay a dime for this. Number two, you are to be here on time to attend each lecture. You sign up at the end of each lecture, there'll be a sign up to get your MCLE credit. You can leave anytime you want, but don't come back. If you miss a session, don't come back unless you make an appointment. Come and talk to me, and I decide that I'm going to let you keep going. For those of you, I see several familiar faces out there who've been practicing bankruptcy law for a while. I don't know that you need this. You are welcome to be here. But my point in doing all this is to get just a few new young bankruptcy lawyers that I could start out on the right path. There's not room in Santa Rosa, in this area, there's room for a couple more bankruptcy attorneys. There's room in the outlying areas, maybe one or two in Marin County, one or two in Lake County, one or two in Mendocino County. But there's not a whole lot of room. There's certainly not a room for everybody in this room. So this is going to be a process of winnowing down. If it's the 10th lecture, I'm down to three or four new faces, I'm going to be perfectly happy. That's my goal. The last thing I want to do, the very last thing, is create any more hacks or crooks or dabblers or people that don't take bankruptcy law and the practice of law seriously. Especially for you young lawyers, you work long and hard to get your ticket. And you don't, the point of doing all that work was not to make money. There's a lot easier ways to make money than being a lawyer. The purpose of it was to be a professional, to have some self-respect and some self-satisfaction. And that, for the next 10 weeks, that's what I'm going to try to instill. If you're just interested in dabbling, if you're interested, there's really horrible things going on right now insofar as bankruptcy law is concerned. There are people out there who are treating law as a business and just trying to suck people in. They're using a couple different scams I've seen. One is that they advertise on TV or the radio, come in and see us and we'll negotiate a deal with your creditors. And when they don't negotiate the deal, then they do a bankruptcy form, end up charging $2,000, $4,000. It's just gross. The purpose of these lectures, for me, is to get two or three or four new lawyers to bankruptcy who act responsibly, who know what they're doing, and to get personal satisfaction out of the practice, and above all, above everything else, to do a good job for your clients. That's my purpose here. For those of you who are here for MCLE credit, you're welcome. It's going to be a long series, and this will be the first time I've done it, so I'm going to be improvising as I go. I don't really know from one time to the next exactly what my subject matter is going to be. But at the end of this, for those of you that stick it out, I hope you will feel that you have got yourself on the road, the beginning of being a bankruptcy lawyer. At the end of all this, you will know maybe 5% of bankruptcy, what there is to know about bankruptcy law. But hopefully you'll be able to at least start out with the smaller consumer cases and build up from there. Bankruptcy law really doesn't get interesting, really, really interesting, until you're talking about $1 million, $10 million, $100 million. That's when it gets fun. But you have to work your way through that. But it's entirely possible if you work hard and if you study hard and if you do a good job for each client that comes through the door, it progresses. So for the next 10 weeks, I'm going to try to teach you how to get started. From then, you're on your own. Now, I style these as a lecture as opposed to what I usually do here, which is a seminar. Oh, by the way, the marshal wanted me to announce, your cell phone rings, you're out. So you want to make sure your cell phones are all on. Ordinarily, I'm not much of a hard ass, but obviously I've got many more people here than I had anticipated. And at some point I just have to start asking people to leave just so I can get the number down. So hopefully you won't be asked to leave. Hopefully you won't lose out on the experience because your cell phone rang. I don't really want any of that kind of distraction. Now, as far as my style, my preferred style is more of a seminar style where I respond to questions. It makes it more interesting for me, and oftentimes it's more beneficial to the group. With this larger group, at least until we get down to half our size, that's going to be difficult. I will, at least for now, I will entertain questions. If you don't mind, if I know I'm going to be covering the topic later, or you're taking me too far off subject, I'm going to have to give you a curt response to your questions. I apologize for that ahead of time. But if you don't mind taking the risk of having me shine you on, you may ask questions. And if they're germane to what I'm talking about, I actually appreciate it. The most important thing I have to teach you today and for the next 10 weeks is the thing I can't teach you. And that's how to have self-respect. But it's a theme that I will come back to over and over again. Because if you don't have that, you have nothing, and I can't teach you anything. All of you should have gotten the email of the initial materials for the course. The first thing on there, did you see it? It's the rights and responsibilities of Chapter 13, debtors and their attorneys. You notice it's from the, yes?
I don't have one of those.
I have extra copies, you can get them afterwards. You'll notice this is from the Oakland Division. You may ask, where's the one for Santa Rosa? There isn't one from Santa Rosa. I consider stuff like this to be consulting. If I were a lawyer practicing the Oakland Division and the court put this forward, I would say directly, Judge, I don't need you to tell me how to represent my clients. I don't need you to tell me what you expect of me, because I guarantee you that what I expect of myself and my clients is far more than your minimums. And by promulgating, writing this down, what the court expects of a lawyer, it gives people a false impression that this is all you have to do. And that's just dead wrong. What you have to do is what your client needs. And you don't need anybody except yourself to know what that is. You don't need some court or anyone else telling you that this is what is expected of you, because you know that whatever is in there is far less than you demand of yourself. And this is part of what I'm talking about, self-respect. Representing a client is such a great privilege. That's why I consider, like, class action lawyers, lawyers without clients, that's not being a lawyer. What's being a lawyer is helping people through their problems. And that is the fundamental basis of what being a bankruptcy lawyer is. It's not about sucking people in and charging them as if they were customers. Clients are not customers. They're looking to you for advice. When a client makes an appointment to talk to you, you sit down, lawyer to client, face to face, not a secretary, not a paralegal, not a screener. You sit down face to face, you shake hands, and you say, what can I do for you? Tell me about yourself, tell me about your problems. And you listen, and you take notes. And after you've listened for a while, then you start talking to your client about the client's options, making sure that the client knows and you know the client comes first. This consultation is not about you making money. This consultation is about giving the client sound advice. And that sound advice, maybe don't file a bankruptcy, at least not right now. If I made an appointment to come in to see you, and you sat down with me and you asked me, what can I do for you? And I told you that I've been really sick and I've had a series of operations and I run up huge medical bills and I can't afford to pay them. And it looks like bankruptcy is the only way out for me. What's the first question you ask me? Anybody?
How are you doing?
Exactly. How are you now? If it turns out your client is going to need at least two or three more operations, is it in your client's best interest to file a bankruptcy right now? Maybe not. Maybe the best thing is to wait or to file a Chapter 13. But the point is, you listen to your client's problem and you give your client advice, you give your client choices. And they have nothing to do with you. And everything to do with what your client needs. And sometimes, oftentimes, that advice is not to file a bankruptcy right now. If you are, if you have a consumer bankruptcy practice, and you're not advising a good 10%, maybe more, of the people who come to see you, don't file or don't file right now. And you have to take a close look at yourself and decide whether you're being a bankruptcy lawyer or a bankruptcy hack. But the client always comes first. And let me tell you something else. The attorneys who put their personal need for income aside, who only listen to the clients and only advise them to do what's best for the clients and not for them, and are not looking to make a buck, those are the attorneys that do the best. At the end of the day, when you take a look at their income, they do very well. Maybe not as good as the crooks. Actually, probably better. Probably better. The crooks are only here as long as the bad times are here. And as soon as times get better again, they'll be off trying to cheat some other type of people besides somebody who's down on their luck in person life. But you need the self-respect to remember at all times that you're not in business to sell bankruptcies. You are a lawyer whose only job is to do right by your client, whatever the client needs. Now, I want to talk a little bit about your representation, your reputation as a lawyer, because a lot of people do not understand how important the reputation is. If your client comes to see you and your client needs a bankruptcy is this. Your clients are like your flock. And there's a lot of wolves out there. There's a lot of people that would like to take advantage of your client for one reason or another. Your job as a lawyer is to shepherd them through their process. And every bankruptcy lawyer has a reputation. If your reputation is all you care about is getting your fee out of your client, if your reputation is that you're not willing to roll up your sleeves and do whatever the client needs, that gets around. It gets around to attorneys for creditors who might object to your client's bankruptcy or object to the dischargeability of the debt. It gets around to the United States trustee who might bring a motion to dismiss your client's case for substantial abuse. Everybody knows what kind of a lawyer you are. It's a small community. Now, some lawyers have the reputation for being sometimes as bad as pit bulls. I won't use the term pit bull, I'll use the term guard dog. The very best attorneys have a reputation of being a guard dog, which the reputation is, these are my clients, you don't mess with them. And the reason you don't mess with them is because of me. These are my charges. And if you take action against my clients, you have to deal with me, because that's what they paid me for, and that's who I am. There are other attorneys, everybody knows, don't do anything extra. Just do the minimum necessary. So if you, for instance, the United States trustee knows, well, this attorney, if I bring a motion to dismiss this case, they're all over in Chapter 13 like nothing. Just won't fight at all. Just take the path of least resistance. Everybody knows who everybody else is and how hard they try for your clients. The three or four people in this room that I'm trying to teach over the next 10 weeks how to be bankruptcy lawyers will hopefully be guard dogs. Now, I'll give you an example. One thing that's very common in bankruptcy is objections to the discharge of a particular debt, typically for fraud. In your either rights or responsibilities or in your own fee agreements, nobody expects you to work to protect himself or herself by putting in the fee agreement. If there's an adversary proceeding, in other words, this kind of an objection, that's going to be extra. It's standard. What the good lawyers don't tell their clients is, in my mind, there's two types of actions creditors might take. Number one is entirely justified. There's allegations of fraud and wrongdoing, and we discussed this in our consultations, and this is likely to crop up, and if it does, we'll just have to deal with it. If it does, it's extra. And there are other types of objections which are just pure harassment. The creditor is doing this in order to try to squeeze, even though everybody knows at the end of the day there's no merit to the action. The good attorneys, the good bankruptcy attorneys, have this little secret. And the secret is, if it's legitimate and my clients want to hire me, then that's fine, or they can hire somebody else and that's going to be extra. But if this is somebody just trying to squeeze my clients don't know this because I don't tell them, but if that's what I think is happening, I'm in. We'll worry about my compensation later, because nobody squeezes my client. So, right from the beginning, you need to establish a good representation. And that does not mean you're a jerk. There are definitely some jerks who practice bankruptcy law, as there are in every area of law. But it means that you look out for your clients and you don't let anybody push them around, and you don't let yourself get a reputation for anyone who lets your clients get pushed around. Let us talk a little bit. I'm getting my soapbox stuff out of the way. So we can get down to the nitty-gritty, but I'm hoping some of this stuff sinks in, because that's really what I'm looking for. I'm not interested in churning out 75 people who know a little bit about bankruptcy law. I'm interested in four or five, or maybe six, or even three, or even four, or even one. Good new bankruptcy lawyer. Now, I'm trying to impress upon you that there's a lot of things that go into the good bankruptcy lawyer, or a good any type of lawyer. I really am trying to give you a feeling for what the attitude that you need to take towards the practice. Now, having been on my soapbox for a little while, does anybody have any questions about what I'm saying? All right, let's move on a little bit. One of the best ways to tell a real bankruptcy lawyer from a hack is to determine how diligent the lawyer is about keeping up on the law. Bankruptcy law is very volatile. The number one aid you need in this day and age, you need an email service that sends you an email of the latest cases, hot off the presses, from at the very least the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeal, the United States Supreme Court, and the Ninth Circuit Bankruptcy Appellate Panel. You've got to know those, and you've got to know those today. I can't tell you how many times the practice of bankruptcy law has flopped from one thing to another based on a decision that comes out of, usually out of the circuit. You've got to know these things. I mean, this goes for any area of practice, but it's especially important in bankruptcy law. And I hate to say this, but there's a fair number of attorneys out there that haven't read a case, any case, in the last 6 months or year. You've got to keep up with this stuff on a daily basis. So whatever the cost is, you got to know about it now. I'll give you a classic example from a few years ago. During the, this was several years ago, back when everybody's house had equity, and they were all interested in keeping their houses and not coughing them back to the bank. One of the district judges held that if you filed for bankruptcy, you forfeited your homestead exemption. Now, that was wrong, but it's something that the good attorneys knew right away. In those days, you had to wait for the recorder to come out, and they printed the copies of the decisions. You had to know about it because it was directly impacted what you did for your clients. And you either said to your client, well, let's hold off, let's see where this goes from here, at least for a couple of weeks, or maybe let's file a Chapter 13, that'll get the creditors off your back, and we'll see where we go from here, because we can always dismiss a Chapter 13. But the last thing you want to do is rush in if filing a bankruptcy is going to result in the forfeit of the homestead exemption. I could probably give you 5 or 6 examples just off the top of my head of things like that where just things happen. A case comes down and it has a big impact. And you've got to know about it. You've got to know about it right away. It often happens that you'll have a case in the process of developing right when a case comes out. You've got to know about the case. You got to be able to understand it and figure out how it applies to the cases you're about to file, so you don't end up with a huge blunder. So that's the number one thing you need, is you need to know about cases now. You also need a library. Now, back in my day, I never read a bankruptcy book I didn't like. You can't have too many resources in your library. At the very least, you need Collier on Bankruptcy, which is, it's fairly expensive. It's loose leaf, and I think it's up to 20 or 30 volumes, but it's kind of the backbone of bankruptcy law. And you need access to the bankruptcy report is probably through Westlaw. But you got to have these things. There is nothing worse than guessing about the law and not knowing it for sure. So If you're going to do bankruptcy seriously, you have to have the resources to back you up. You need the legal resources, you need a good staff. We're talking a minute about staff. Good staff is invaluable. But any law firm that substitutes a paralegal or a secretary for an attorney is shameful, and I see too much of that. The lawyer has got to sit down and have a meaningful discussion directly with the client, not over the telephone. Somebody's got awful, it's not love, I think there's some firm in Southern California that advertises on the internet bankruptcy is cheap and does everything over the telephone, and it's just awful. That's not the practice of law. That's the business of selling bankruptcies. Generally, the way it should work is you sit down with the client, you discuss the client's situation, you point out the options available to the client. Nothing, we can file Chapter 7, we can file a Chapter 13. You allow the client to make the choice. I can't stress how important that is. These choices are all choices for your clients to make, not you. You give your client advice, but at the end of the day, the action the client takes is the client's choice, not yours. Once the decision is made to file a bankruptcy, what most lawyers do is they give the client the questionnaire to fill out. Take this questionnaire and fill it out right back. At that point, it can go to a paralegal or a good secretary to prepare a rough draft of the bankruptcy papers. But then what is required after that is to sit down with the lawyer again to go over the papers carefully. This is a theme that I will come back to over and over again over the next 10 weeks, is the importance of the schedules. They're absolutely critical. And you have to know, when you're filling out bankruptcy papers, a lot of attorneys go wrong because they think that the practice of bankruptcy law is a practice of filling out forms. Nothing could be further from the truth. There's all kinds of choices to be made in the schedules. The number one rule is you never answer any question on any schedule, on any form. You never fill it out without knowing exactly what it's being used for. There is part of the schedules you have to fill in the client's income and expenses. Now, the income is fairly straightforward, although there can be some legal issues involved in that. But you have to, when your client is filling out the expenses, you and your client always have to have in the back of your mind, why are we doing this? If you're filing a Chapter 13, you need to show that the debtor can afford to make the monthly payments that are required for Chapter 13. So you sit down with a client and you look at the rough numbers and you say, well, we better take a closer look at these because either A, according to these numbers, you can't afford to make any payments, maybe we should rethink Chapter 13. Or B, according to these numbers, you can pay quite a bit a month. If you really can't afford to pay that, we better take another look at these numbers, because if you say that you can afford to make $1,000 a month payments, they're going to make you pay $1,000. Can you really afford to do this? You have to know what you're doing this for. I've got one attorney in Chapter 7 cases. I'm going to explain to you in Chapter 7. And let me back up a minute, by the way. We've got 10 weeks for those of you that's going to stick with me for the whole 10-week period. Some of this may seem a little disjointed now. But I'm going to go, we're going to grind our way through. Right now, I'm trying to make some points with you about the lawyer involved in this stuff. I've got one attorney, let me put this right, in Chapter 7 case, under the law, it's been in effect for about 3 years. If you're over the median income, there's a complicated calculation, and if it shows you can pay your debts, you are subject to a motion to dismiss. I've got one attorney, probably got a full page out of the yellow pages if you really want to know. I'm getting started on the yellow pages. One attorney obviously does not review these with his clients, because what happens is he files a case that's over the median income, and the U.S. trustee makes a motion to dismiss the case for abuse. And what's the first thing a sucker does? Every time, every single time, amends the schedule. Now, and amend the schedules, the numbers are different. See, there's no abuse under the right numbers. We had the wrong numbers before, but we got the right numbers now. As you can see, under the right numbers, there's no abuse. Last time he did it, I sanctioned the $500. I just get so tired of that. That's somebody who is not going over the schedules carefully with the client before the case is filed, understanding why these numbers are there. Because if he did that, he could see under these numbers, the U.S. trustee is going to jump right down our throats. So we better make sure they're correct. And in the schedules, there is plenty of room for lawyering and plenty of room for rethinking things without committing anything close to anything false. I'll give you another example of playing with the schedules. Ms. Green, who lost the case recently, you know why? I don't mean to single you out. I'll tell you what happened to me. Debtor files and says her house is worth $520,000. After the filing, there is an appraisal, which turns out the appraisal says, oh, the property may be worth as low as $440,000. So, but at $440,000, we can avoid that second deed of trust. So the first thing they've done is amend the schedules. But the schedules, before they're amended, that's the word from on high. If you've got the schedules down there that said the property was worth $520,000, that's what it's worth. You can't impeach yourself. Your client can't impeach himself or herself. Now, you can amend the schedules, but that does not make the original schedules as if poof, they've gone away. It's still an admission against interest and still entirely admissible. So the point is, and I don't mean to single you out as if you did something wrong. I bring this up because it's a classic example of not fully thinking about where you want to go when you start the case. And I have a feeling in that case it was just serendipitous and it was a good stab. But the point is, as a judge, once the original schedules come in that high, you can't really ask me. You can amend the schedule to give it a go. But you really can't ask a judge to just ignore those things. It's evidence. And the debtor signed under penalty of perjury. And the, I made a mistake thing. You have to amend the schedules if there's something wrong and you know it's wrong. You've got to amend the schedules. You've got to amend them immediately. But there's no such thing as the right answer to a question like, what's the value of your house? Yes?
Well, one thing that concerns me about that is that what we're seeing in the real estate market right now is that your house is dropping in value virtually day by day.
Yeah.
So it really will happen that you may file and say it's worth $525 at the time you file.
Absolutely.
And it drops.
But the point is, when you're filling out the schedules, you got to have in mind as a lawyer where you're going to go with this. And it varies with the economy. We're in a bad economy now, and there's no equity in anything in real estate. But these things go in cycles. Believe me, in bankruptcy as long as I have, you've seen just about everything. Going in, if you think you might want to try to get rid of that second deed of trust, you want to schedule that value as low as you can legitimately do that. So maybe if that's where you're going, you get your appraisal first, or at least a broker's opinion, and you schedule the property at the lowest possible range that can be legitimately done. The point is, you know going in why they're asking what the value of the house is. And then you fill it out, you advise your client to fill it out in your client's best interest. But you have to know why they're asking. And you have to know the law in order to properly do that. If you just tell your paralegal to help the client fill out the schedules, you end up with dunderhead schedules. And then after the filing, when you see, we should have done it this way, and you amend, well, the amend will do a little bit of good, but it won't undo all the damage. Your client has made a damaging admission under penalty of perjury. It's hard to get around something like that. So what I'm trying to impart to you is the need for fully understanding the schedules and filling them out strategically. And especially in the area of valuations and expenses, there is a lot of different things you can do depending on where you want to go. Yes?
Does it cut the other way? I mean, if, for example, I just saw a schedule where someone appraised their house at $300,000. It seemed low for the area. I got an appraisal, and I'm on the other side, of course, at $420,000. So does it cut the other way, too, that somebody, to me it seemed like a deliberate attempt to mislead. It was off by $120,000. So my question to you is, does it cut, if a debtor does that and chooses such a number that's so low and is not borne out by any information except their own belief, is there any remedy that the court would put on that debtor for choosing that number?
Well, the lesson I'm trying to impart to you is don't make an admission through ignorance. Now, I talked about reputation before. You do not ever want to get a reputation as an attorney who files false schedules. And I'm sure I don't need to tell you this, but as a bankruptcy lawyer, you will have clients who from time to time will tell you, sometimes fairly along in the bankruptcy process, that they decided to leave something out. You know, that $5,000 loan that I repaid my mom 6 months ago, let's just not mention that. And there's only, I know I don't have to tell you this, but there's only one response to that from the lawyer's standpoint, which is there's the door. You want to file, you want to use me to be your attorney, you'll be 100% honest, not 90% or not 92%. And the income that I would get in this case is nothing, nothing compared to my self-respect. Many is the time clients told me they're not going to be honest in their schedules, and I said, I'm sorry, I'm not taking your case. And then a few months later, I'll be 341 hearing, and I'll see them there, and they'll be with another attorney or pro se, and I don't care. I know they've left it out. Completely privileged, I'm not saying that, but I'm not doing it. Not something that I'm responsible for, because I have self-respect for myself in a role as a lawyer. Now, that having been said, you have to advise your client, we want the lowest value in this property that we can legitimately testify to. And that may entail getting a broker, an appraisal or a broker's opinion beforehand. But if they have something that legitimately justifies it, then I think it's perfectly proper. I've seen all kinds of classic things. I saw a dinner one time that scheduled a 1990 Corvette, and that was the schedule, 1990 Corvette, value $15,000, and they put the VIN number on it, and I happened to recognize the VIN number as being, yes, it's a 1990 Corvette ZR1, which the engine was a $30,000 option. I called him on that. I'm sure that's the last thing that that debtor ever expected. That's beyond the pale. That's dishonesty, and you have nothing to do with it. But, you know, it's your client's call, and you tell your client, you're the one that has to sign this under penalty of perjury. And you need a legitimate basis for it. If you don't have a legitimate basis, we could put your bankruptcy in jeopardy. On the other hand, we need the lowest number that you can legitimately come up with. You explain this to your client, it's your client's call. There's a question over here. Yeah.
Yeah, well, it's the, oh, by the way, I forgot to tell you after you've already filed.
Well, you can file an amendment right away. And the most important thing, with oh, by the ways, the most important thing is you expose it before someone has a chance to ask you about it. Typically.
So, can I just, I'm sorry.
Go ahead. If it's before the 341 hearing, you amend the schedules immediately. Of course, serve a copy on the trustee. If it's just before the 341 hearing, you don't have time to do that. You go to the 341 hearing, and before anybody says anything, you say, I want to make one thing clear. We've just discovered that we left this and that off. You put that on the record beforehand. Because if you wait until somebody asks you a question, or asks your client a question about it, then it might look like your client is trying to intentionally hide it. So with the, oh, by the way, you want to get them on the record one way or another, as soon as you can, So nobody can say that you only admitted it, you only amended the schedules because somebody came to the 341 hearing and asked an embarrassing question. That puts your client in jeopardy.
Okay, I'm going to take it a step further. You get caught flat-footed at a 341 hearing. You didn't know anything about it.
Who didn't know?
The attorney.
Okay.
I'll give you the example. Showed up at a 341 hearing, by the way, didn't know, the trustee held up something from the internet and said, you own real estate in another country. You didn't, and the attorney was caught flat-footed. Now you're in a fiduciary responsibility with the client, but now you know the client's lying to you.
Well,
you can't just show him the door because you've already undertaken representation.
You don't turn on your client and say you lied to me.
No, well, no. I mean, you may say that privately, but I'm saying that you've got a fiduciary responsibility.
Your responsibility is to amend the schedules immediately. You explain to your client ahead of time. You got to be entirely honest with me, because if somebody else comes forward with this stuff and it's not in our schedules, we could lose the discharge. Let me take one step back and talk about the discharge. In the olden days, the discharge, we're going to go until 10 after 5, by the way, today. In the old days, in most cases, a debtor can get a discharge. That discharge was gold, because a lot of debtors didn't get them. If you go outside here, there's a discharge from 1842. It's got a gold seal on it with a piece of silk ribbon, and that was in somebody's safe deposit box for a century and a half, because it was an extremely valuable document. You file a bankruptcy to get a discharge. Anything that puts the discharge in jeopardy has to be thought out very carefully. What happened was, in starting with the bankruptcy code, well, it really started with the act in 1898, but especially under the code, discharges got to be so fairly automatic. A lot of attorneys lost sight of the fact that the goal of a filing is to get a discharge. Any case that you don't get a discharge is a failure. Any case where you do get a discharge is a success. Now, the law was changed 3 years ago. It's not so easy to get a discharge. There are a fair number of people that don't get them. So you always have to keep that goal in mind. What I saw happening during the early 80s is the discharge seemed so automatic to many attorneys that they started advising their clients to do very risky, if not stupid, things in order to maximize their exemptions. They got this crazy notion that the goal of the bankruptcy lawyer was to help the debtor exempt as much as possible, which to some extent is true, but not to the extent where it puts a discharge in jeopardy, and you can get there. So there's some choices that have to be made, and of course there are choices for the client. It's the lawyer's job to set them out, have the client make the final choice. But you have to keep in your mind that the purpose of the filing is to get that discharge. And you don't want to do anything which might jeopardize it without thinking long and hard. And you tell your client, we have to list everything, because if we leave something off, it could jeopardize the discharge. And that's the worst of all situations. As you go through bankruptcy, you have to give up your non-exempt property, you have subject examination of creditors, you have all the downside of bankruptcy, and you come out of it without that discharge at the other end. That's a disaster. So part of your job is to make it clear to your client. You're going to have clients who weren't fully truthful with you. Frankly, not that many, but you will have some. And at the end of the day, you have to say to yourself, well, first of all, I did everything that I was supposed to do, honestly, and secondly, I stressed to my client the importance of putting anything that might be important down, because the consequences of failing to do that is loss of the discharge. All right. I think I'm about to start on the nuts and bolts. And I think this is probably a good place to break for a week. I have the sign-up sheets in front of me. You need to be on this sign-up sheet to be admitted next week. That goes for week after week. If you're not on the weeks before sign-up sheet, you can't come back for the next time unless you made an appointment, come in to see me, talk to me person to person, and I've given you permission to keep going. So that's all we have for now. Starting next time, we will get much more into the nuts and bolts of it. But I hope that I've given you a general overview.